2010 and worked as Dean, Faculty of Engineering, Punjab University, Chandigarh. He's having industrial work experience with DCM Engineering Products and Swaraj Mazda Limited before joining NITR Chandigarh. He authored five books, one published by Markel Decker New York and two others by Springer. And a book on CNC machine is very popular and is being used on in teaching on all levels, diploma, UG and PG. He has guided more than 10 students at PhD and more than 125 MTech thesis and 12 are under progress. He has published more than 125 research papers at international, national research journals and conference. And he's also having international exposure as he has visited various universities in Canada, UK, US, and Hong Kong. He's actively involved with national level bodies like AICT, NBA, and in R&D projects with Punjab State Council of Science and Technology, and his research interests are manufacturing technology and computers in manufacturing. On behalf of Baba Farid College of Engineering and Technology, we welcome you, sir, to speak over today's topic, Artificial Intelligence in Robotics.
Thank you, Engineer Pankaj Mittal. Thank you for introducing. A nice introduction you have given. Very good afternoon to all of you, all the participants. First of all, let me thank your head of the department, Dr. Tejinder Pal Rao, who has been my student also earlier, and he has invited me to talk to you on very important aspect of AI in robotics. Before I start, I would like to thank the management and principal of your college, Baba Farid College of Engineering and Technology at Bathinda. I have not got the chance to visit, although Dr. Tejinder T.P. Singh has been inviting me. Anyway, it is good that you have invited me to be with you remotely. We will talk on a very important topic, that is robotic, AI in robotics. We all know that these two disciplines now, actually. You see, although we say that AI is a discipline under computer science and robotics is basically interdisciplinary, but we take it under mechanical engineering. So these two are very important aspects these days, where everybody is talking and there are a lot of jobs available in this if you work seriously on this. The importance can be gauged from the aspect that there are many institutions who are offering BTEC programs, master's programs on robotics, on AI. Even our institute, National Institute of Technical Teacher Training and Research, we are offering two programs. One is master's in mechanical engineering with specialization in robotics. Second one is master's in computer science and engineering, artificial intelligence. No, master's, it is with electronics department. So these are very powerful tools, very full powerful technologies, which have affected the whole gamut of activities in our lives. The third aspect, which has contributed, which has changed, which has emerged as a disruptive technology, that is IoT, Internet of Things, or we say, for our purpose, we say it is IIoT, Industrial Internet of Things. Let us try to go ahead. To the participants, I will request that you, because you may not be allowed to talk by the program manager. Please write your queries in the chat box. Within the lecture or at the end of the lecture, I would like to go to the chat box and try to answer your queries, whatever it is, right? So I will share the PPT now. Just let me know when it is there, okay. Priya madam, is it visible? Hello? Is it visible, my PPT? Anybody? One of you have to tell me that my this is visible or not.
Yes, sir. Yeah. It's visible, sir.
Okay. So let's start. I will request you to note down your questions and ask as many questions as you wish. But please do ask questions. So this is the topic I have been given by the coordinator of the program. As I said, these are two independent topics, and when merged, it emerges as a much, much stronger topic than we can think, right? And one thing I want to, because many of you may be from non-computer branches, artificial intelligence is not computer only. It is an interdisciplinary subject. We all have to learn, and we all can contribute. I, as a mechanical engineer, I can contribute. You, somebody is from electrical engineering, he can contribute. Even people from non-engineering disciplines are contributing in artificial intelligence, because artificial intelligence is not limited to engineering only. Applications, directions, rules are coming from other disciplines, maybe something from sociology, something from psychology, something from history. They are all contributing, something from finance, artificial intelligence, because artificial intelligence applications are everywhere in all domains of life. Now let's see what is this artificial intelligence and robotics. These are two very powerful and sought after areas with wide applications. If you talk to anybody, especially because we are all from academics, if you talk to anybody, everybody wants to work in AI. And everybody wants to apply AI somewhere, right? I'm not saying robotics only. But robotics is another area, which is a hot area, which is a focus area, where it is again an interdisciplinary area, right? Application may be mechanical, application may be in medical, application may be in day-to-day life, application may be in your own home. But it is interdisciplinary area. So they are all, these are two basically independent areas with large scope for application. And if I talk in our language, there is large scope for employment also after you learn it. AI and robots both try to do routine and complex tasks, taking over the work which was earlier in the exclusive domain of humans. When we say AI also, we basically talk about smart machines, right? Robots also are smart machines only. So what do they do? They can do your routine tasks, right? Like a robot can be a pick and place. It will pick some component from one place and put it on another place. AI can be programmed, AI can be used to intervene even in simple tasks. But there are complex tasks which human beings independently may not be able to do, or we do not want to do those tasks. These are dangerous tasks, right? Or our routine motion, because we have two hands, it may not be allowing us to do those type of complex tasks, which robots can do, which AI can help the robots in doing. Right? If you that means it is a powerful combination of AI and robotics. It enhances the capacity and capability of robots. AI is already there. AI is being used in other sectors also. But when you combine it with robots, it makes the robots awful. It increases the capacity and capability of the robots. The presence of AI in different spheres of work has been increasingly felt. Every day we are feeling. You just look at your house itself. You have a washing machine. You can program it, right? It can take a decision. If the temperature goes some beyond this, it can cut off the power supply. If something extraordinary noise is coming into the machine, you can have a sensor and it can stop the machine from working. It can switch it off. The power supply can be switched off. But robotics is also another field where AI has been used, where AI is finding increased application. So robotics is not an exception. Robotics is with other things only. If we are using AI in developing an expert system, robotics is also there. Robotics also we can be having, we can have AI based, that means intelligent robots we can have. So what AI has done? AI in robotics has introduced flexibility and learning capabilities in previously rigid applications. Earlier, the applications were rigid. You can say, okay, the robot will follow this path. It will follow the same path. If something happens, maximum it will stop. But now, probably what we can do is, let's say the robot is going and you find an obstacle. The robot can decide based on the AI application, what is the alternate route available to it? The robot can decide whether it can unload the material at that place, or can the material go to some other place, or the material has to go to the pre-decided destination only, then what is the route? Right? So, and there is a provision for learning while doing. That means when you are, the robot is working, it can work. That means, for example, the robot is programmed to go to a particular place. Every time it goes to in a particular direction, there is an obstacle in between. So what robot will do? Depending on how it has been programmed, let's say we program it that if the obstacle is found 5 times in a row, then robot will say, okay, this path is not available because it has an intelligence mind inside it. It has an intelligent mind inside it. So it will cross that path. It will say, no, I will not go to that path. I will always take other options. I will evaluate other options. Right? Now, let's see what is the artificial intelligence. Now, one thing I want to tell you is, what I am going to talk today, it may not be available in any book. It is just an application side of what we are talking, right? It may not match the actual definitions of AI or robotics. I sat and made the presentation so that we as non-computer people, we understand the importance and application of AI in robotics. So please don't try to map it to the book applications. Now, what is intelligence? I will say this is my definition of intelligence is the ability to take decision in given situations, especially where there are no pre-existing solutions. Right? One is that you have a pre-existing, you know that this was done earlier, so I will do this just now. Whereas there may be situations which you are finding it for the first time. There are no set rules, right? There are no even situations. You cannot probably follow a IS code, BIS code and get the solution. No, there may be a decision. There may be simpler decision also. Let's say you have to take a decision on availability of two paths, which path you will go. You have the algorithms available. You can have the traveling salesman problem you can solve and decide the path. But there may be other situations where there is no set rule which needs innovative thinking. So that is intelligence, right? You just see in your mind. One is that somebody tells you that you do that work, you go and do that work. Second is, nobody is there to guide you. You have to take a decision. That is intelligence. Then there is word artificial. What is that artificial? It is not natural. The intelligence which we have as human being, that is naturally, we are blessed with that artificial intelligence, with that intelligence. We can take decisions, right? But when we try to embed, when we try to put intelligence in non-natural things, right? In a machine. That is called artificial intelligence. It is not natural, but we try to make that machine behave like a human being, that it should take decisions as the human being takes, right? One is that if there is an obstacle, a human being will also not go and strike with the obstacle. The robot will also not do that. But human being is so strong, so much of capability it has, that you can read the emotions of the others. The person in front of you, what he is doing, what will be his behavior, you can probably read sometimes. But the machines cannot read. People are still working on reading of emotions also. That is, we call it as human-machine interaction. So artificial intelligence is a branch of computer science. We have been saying till now, right? But artificial intelligence is developing as a branch itself. It is an interdisciplinary now. It may be software come hardware. It involves developing computer programs to complete tasks that would otherwise require human intelligence. That means what we are trying to do. We are trying to make programs. Now programs, soft computing is another one thing. Third is, you integrate these programs with the machines. The machines, as you see, actually what the decision is being taken by the, based on the computer program. What we think that the machine is taking a decision. Of course, that computer program is also embedded in the control system of the machine. So what we are doing? Artificial intelligence is a branch of computer science. It involves developing computer programs, writing algorithms and programs to complete tasks that would otherwise require human intelligence, which otherwise in human intelligent, human beings will do it, and with their limited calculation capabilities, limited calculation speed, they may take longer than what your programs are taking. Right? AI is embedding intelligent decision-taking capabilities in the machines. That is what I have been telling till now. That AI is basically, we are trying to embed the intelligent decision-taking capabilities. Why I'm doing intelligent? That means there should be rational decisions. They should be acceptable decisions. They should be economically and financially viable. They should be doable. They should not take a decision that you will walk and go to, let's say, from Chandigarh to Delhi. It will take long. That is not a very practical decision. They will tell me a mode of transport which will be economical and optimal. So AI is embedding intelligent decision making taking capabilities in the machines. There are some examples, right? Now, you may not find as it is in some books. It is a combination of some ideas. You are playing a chess game on computer. Now, depending upon your action, what action you are taking, computer takes a better action than you. Now, computer is not otherwise it is not an intelligent machine. But when you have put some software which can take decisions, which have been told, which has been programmed to take a decision based on your activity, what action you have taken. And what the computer does, it has very fast computing capabilities. So it explores all the possibilities. What can happen? What you can do as a human being? So it blocks your moves. So it is AI basically, because your decision is not predictable. Or what the computer can do, it will say that this person always follows this route. So it will try to block that route first. Driverless car. Right? We are talking about driverless cars. What decision it takes? It is not a static decision. These are dynamic decisions. And these decisions are based on the environment, physical environment, which is available. Based on that, sometimes there may be a person in front of the car, sometimes there will be a car coming from the other side, sometimes there will be cars coming from two sides or three sides, what type of decision it has to take. And maybe if it finds that there is a clear road, to what distance it can see, it can increase the speed of the car, right? How do you understand? It can take the audio commands also from you. You say stop, or just see, the examples are with you. You have your phone, you say call Mr. such and such, the mobile calls that. Right? Robotic assistants in surgery. A person sitting in Bangalore can conduct the surgery in Chandigarh, in Sangrur, in Bathinda. Manpower forecast. Let's say you want to do what type of manpower it will do. That AI can tell you based on the data available. There's a lot of data available on the internet. You don't even have to give the data. The computer can, this programs can pick up data from the cloud. Cloud data is available and take a decision for you. Right? And we are surprised. You go to Google. You search for something, and next time you go to Google, it will tell you that you search for this and these are the options for you to purchase these items. You see that? Right? So it can go do even your manpower forecasting. It can do what type of stocks you should invest in the market. I'm talking about AI. I'm not talking about AI in robotics. Planning, scheduling, and rescheduling. You can make plans with the AI with the given inputs, what type of items will be required by the customers over a period of time. You can schedule the manufacturing or sales. And if there are some other signals coming, you can reschedule everything. You can reschedule the production plans, marketing plans. So this is what AI can do for you without you interfering. But very important aspect is that while writing the program, while developing the algorithms, we have to be very careful. What do we want? What are the input factors? Now, these AI programs will work correctly only if there has been programming has been done correctly and we have been able to take the all the factors which will influence. Right? There are techniques, we will not go into it. Because this may not be the right form to talk to you on what are the techniques in AI. But we can use for this. These are some of the examples. There are n number of examples. There are huge applications of AI in all fields, right? Artificial intelligence uses mathematical modeling of processes, right? Very convenient, unless you are that is what I said, that we should be able to model the process. We should be able to decide what are the factors which are contributing to the outcome of a particular process. How is the relative importance? How is the relative effect of the factors? And what is the outcomes we want? How the outcome is? How does the factors affect the outcome? Statistical techniques. You know, we study statistical techniques. They are widely used. All these aspects of mean, median, mode, standard deviation, variance, all these are used, right? Statistical techniques are used to predict the action to be taken. What action is to be taken? Do we want to interpolate? Do we want to extrapolate? What do we want? Statistical techniques are widely used in AI. If you want to, let's say you start learning machine learning. Machine learning is another technique. They will first start with statistical techniques, statistics. Optimization techniques are used to give optimum decision. You see, for doing a task, you may have many alternatives, more than one alternatives. Then you have to decide. Let's say you want to go from one place to another place. You may have two routes. One route will take half an hour. The other route will take 45 minutes. But the half an hour route may be costly. There may be a toll tax, toll plaza on that. So you have to decide whether you want to pay the toll and reach early, or you want to avoid the toll tax and reach, maybe spend another 15 minutes. So that type of decision, we have optimization techniques are there, which can give you the optimal decisions. We say best decision under the given circumstances, right? Interdisciplinary theories and rules to make inferences. You want to reach a decision, you want to make an inference. You may be, have to go to mathematics, you may have to go to basic sciences, you may have to go to history, you may have to go to psychology, right? That all that is integrated into the programs. There's a mechanism to improve the decision-making process. That means you have started it, you had some inputs that, okay, this will be the inputs. But let's say you say that if A or B is equal to 0, then C is equal to 0, right? Let's say I have a rule like that. If A is equal to 0 or B is equal to 0, then C is equal to 0. But after working for some time, the program finds that A or B, one of them is always 0. So it will permanently say C is 0, always 0. So it will not even check the condition whether A or B, A is 0 or B is 0. So that is basically what we call it a self-learning. That may be supervised learning or unsupervised learning. That means it may be automatic, or you can have a set of data and train the system. Inputs from various sensing devices, that is called sensors, to make decisions. The decisions either are software based, or you have the sensors, which will give you inputs and you take a decision. Right? Let's say we come to collision detection only, two vehicles should not collide. That will be a sensor, at least on one vehicle. And the other vehicle will respond in the sense that you send a signal to the other vehicle, and there is something from which the signal will be reflected and come back to the first vehicle. So it can see how much time it has taken, time of flight you call it, and you can take a decision whether to stop, whether to take a left turn, whether to take a right turn. And last point is AI is as good as the understanding of the processes by the programmer and mapping of the inputs to the phenomena. AI in itself, if you write AI, nothing. You will not get anything out of it. AI is as good as you understand the processes. To what extent we have understood the phenomena, what we want. And how much you can map to the phenomena, the inputs from the signals. How good is the program? So that is what we say is as good as the programming. But if your programming is good, if your self-learning mechanism is good, your program will keep on improving itself. Ah, AI based, where we have machines, because we are talking about now robotics, AI based machines, or we call it artificially intelligent machines, are those machines which behave externally like humans. You can have a robot, you call it humanoids. It looks like a human being only, right? They behave externally like humans, operate internally as humans too. Now, from outside, when they are interacting with the environment, they work as humans are working, right? They can work as a chowkidar at your house, they can open the gate, they can close the gate. And if you want that only particular type of person should be there, you can tell the robot, you can program the robot that only if you first map the photograph with the persons who is coming, if that photograph maps with one of the persons you have put into the computer memory, only then that robot will open the gate, otherwise it will not open the gate. Operate internally as human too, that means they think, right? Internally also, independently also, they think as humans too. Have computational systems to make the machines behave intelligently and rationally. Right? They have a computational system inside it. Chota computer hai, which will make the machines intelligent because they have to take decisions based on some algorithms, there are some programs, and the decision should be rational. They should be acceptable decision. It should not be non-acceptable. It should not go beyond the set rules. So for that, you need a computational system which will take the inputs and take a decision. Take decision based on computational inputs or sensor inputs, including audio commands, right? The system will take decision based on the insight inputs, right? Based on the computation or from a sensor. Of course, the sensor input will also be converted into a computational data only. What is robot? There are two terms actually. One is called robotics. So what is that? It is a branch of technology that deals with physical robots. That means in development applications, improvements, R&D, where you do all this on robotics, that is called robotics. And the product which you are getting, that is a robot. So robots are programmable machines. They are, I have made it red, they are a programmable machine. That means they have to be programmed, right? There may be a hardware-based programming or there may be a software-based programming. So robots are programmable machines able to carry out a series of actions, right? They will do a number of activities to accomplish the task, right? Robots may be autonomous or semi-autonomous. They may be independent, autonomous, they can take decision. Or semi-autonomous means they are told to take decision, they are told what to do, and they will do the job. You tell them that go 100 meters in the forward direction, they will do it. But in autonomous robots, based on factors, what inputs it is getting, it will go to 100 meters or it may not go, it may stop at 50 meters because some data has come that after 50 meters, it is not safe to go. Another application of robot, the application of robot actually basically, not application, the definition of robot, I have given you the general robot application. Robots are programmable machines. But depending on the application, where you are applying the machine, robot to work out, carry out the work, people are changing the definition also. There is one definition. This general definition is a programmable multifunction manipulator designed to move materials, parts, tools, or specific devices through variable programmed motions for the performance of a variety of tasks. This is the definition given by Robot Institute of America, RIA we call it, right? Just try to read this. Programmable multifunctional manipulator. It manipulates the thing, designed to move materials, because material handling was the first application which robotics started doing. Material, parts, tools, or specific devices through variable programmed motion. It is not necessary that every time it will follow the same motion, same distances, same motion, same path, for performance of a variety of tasks. Because these are programmable machines, the task which the robot is doing just now, in the next moment, it may be doing a different task because you have to just change the program. Now, just see another application, very concise application definition. An active artificial agent whose environment is the physical world. It is basically, it says an artificial agent. Agent is basically, it is doing some work, some application. Artificial agent, artificially created. You see, I can also do, I can pick and place. You can also pick and place. But this is an artificial machine which we have created, which is doing pick and place applications. So an active artificial agent whose environment is the physical world. Now, one thing more comes to this point. Why it is written, whose environment is the physical world? That means it has to interact, it has to do work in the physical world, in the normal environment, right? Now, there are some programs, AI programs, artificial intelligence programs, which do optimization, which do all the functions of they want to evaluate all the options available, but we don't call them a machine actually, because they are not interacting with the physical world, whereas a robot is interacting with the physical world. So it is an artificial agent. Now, three most important characteristics of a robot are that robots are programmable. We have seen from the definition. Because this is the second day almost gone. Now you must have been talked, you must have discussed with one or more of the experts. So robots are programmable. Robots interact with the physical world via sensors and actuators. Right? They have sensors which will sense different parameters, and sensors Dr. Dhami has covered in the morning, and actuators, and there will be actuators who will take action, based on the sensor inputs through some control mechanism. Robots may be autonomous or semi-autonomous. They may be taking independent decision, or they may be asked to take a decision. They may be instructed to take some decisions. Now, what are the normal sensors? We have force sensors. I'm sure you know all this. Tactile sensors, sonar sensors, vision sensors, vibration sensors, audio sensors based on noise, or we may be having natural language processing. And there is another sensor which we want to integrate into the robotics, which is there in the human beings. That is called proprioceptive, or proprioceptors. What is that? Because it's a new term, I wrote the application also for you. Proprioception, what is that? Is the sense through which we perceive the position and movement of our body, including our sense of equilibrium and balance. Senses that depend on the notion of force. What are this proprioception or proprioceptives? Let's say I close my eyes and I can again put my finger on my nose. I can put my finger, I can touch my thumb of my left hand without opening my eyes. Right? Without looking at the floor, I can sense through my feet whether there is a stone, there is a marble stone, or it is a grass stone. So these are the proprioceptive or proprioceptive receptors. Through those sensors, I come to those conclusion that now I am walking on grass. Even I will not be seeing it. If I there is no grass, I will say, okay, now there is no grass. Now it is a pakka path. This may be a brick path. It may be a, I can see, I can tell from the my feel of my feet only that this is a grass. This is maybe carpet. This is bricks. This is marble. Without looking at the actual path, what is there, I can say, I can decide, I can sense what type of floor it is there. So it is proprioceptive sensing. What are the, I'm not going into all the operations that this is application, but some of the applications which are very common, where do we prefer robots, right? Work environment which is hazardous for human being. Nobody wants to work in a paint shop. Nobody wants to work in a chemical factory, which are hazardous for human being. I can put computers there. Computers will never complain. Of course, I have to take care that if it is a hazardous environment, what type of preventive actions I should do on the robotics parts so that there is no wear and tear. Repetitive tasks. Robots are very good at repetitive tasks. If you put a person on a repetitive task, because the task is repetitive and the human beings are likely to miss one or two of the steps after some time. But robots will not work. They will not forget it. They will not miss anything. This red color precision work I have read, where you need repetitiveness, what we call. We need very precise and accurate work, where human beings can err. They can commit errors. We will put computers there. We will put robots there. Once you have told what to do, and probably once you have trained the robot, maybe you check one or two components. After that, you can be very sure that the work will be repeated with the required precision. Monotonous, boring, and unpleasant tasks, which nobody wants to do. I don't want to stand in sun outside. You put a robot. You don't want to do night patrolling along the international border. You put a robot. A robot will never tire. It will never complain also that I am tired. It will never complain that you have put me in the cold night. No, you just design it accordingly and it will not say no. It will do it continuously. Multi-shift operations, that means they can continuously work. They don't tire. Infrequent changeovers, where there are changeovers are, you see, setup time may be very high for the reports. First one or two components or operations may be very, very time consuming. But once you set up, the repetition will be there. Whereas if you are putting a human being can be asked to do a separate job. He is doing some job, he can be just asked to do the separate job. He will immediately start doing it if he knows it. Whereas computer, it may take time to change over for the robot. They will produce at a steady pace. When we have a human beings, human operators, there are issues. In the first 2 hours, they will produce very good. Production rate will be very high. Whereas after that, there will be tiredness, there will be tea break, there will be some meeting. So the performance may come down. Whereas in case of robots, the performance will be steady, uniform. And if you have to give some realistic schedules, dispatch schedules to your clients, you can give it this way, and you can be very sure that because now it is a computer controlled, it is not a human control, you are assured of the delivery dates. Long hours, responding in automated operations, that means in automated operations, it can interface with the machine. Let's say you want to put a robot to load a job on, let's say, lathe machine. So it will interface with the lathe, and it will make sure, because it has been designed to do that, that unless the spindle stops, it will not go near the spindle. Once the spindle stops, it will open its jaw, its own end effector, and hold the jaw. It will not start pulling its jaw out. No, it will get a signal that the clamping has opened, chuck has opened. Then only it will pick. That means you can interface this with other machines, and it can start working. It can minimize variation, as I said. Okay, these are some of the robots. A very, very important aspect of decision making, because I intentionally wrote this, is in material handling robots. Now let us see, you have a box. You have the bottommost box. There's nothing lying. Let's say the platform is empty, vacant. Now you ask the robot to pick a box from somewhere and put it at the platform. In the first instance, nothing is there. There's no box already on that platform. So what do? The robot can place the box at any place. Okay, that place is decided that it will first place the box at such and such place. But in the next instance, when it brings the next box, now that location where it has put the earlier box, that is not available. Now it has to take a decision. Either you program it, that every time you take it, let's say the height of the box is 1 feet, it should come and leave the box. Earlier it was at 0 feet from the ground, then it should be at 1 feet, then 2 feet. Or it has to keep parallel to the earlier box, on the left side, right side, what side? One is that you give the coordinates first. Second is you have a mechanism, you have a sensor, you have a vision sensor, you have a camera which can see and send the signal to the control system, and it can decide based on where the box is, earlier box is, or where is the available position for keeping the box. Now if the size of the box changes, what should it say? That means we should have information about the box. Either we should store it, we should tell the machine in software, or we should have a mechanism of getting the signal, right? Now let us see. Now we are trying to, we have just talked about what is AI and what is a robot. Artificially intelligent robot, basically machine, they are AI machines, are the bridge between robotics and AI. AI is different, robotics is different. So when you say AI, you put into the robot, it becomes a combination of two important fields, robotics and AI. These robots that are controlled by AI programs. You just by putting a computer with the robot doesn't help. You need to have a program to control it. You need to decide what you want. When decision making is required, AI programs are used. Wherever you need a decision based on soft inputs or in sensor inputs, you need to make a decision, then you need the algorithm. It may be simple algorithm, it may be a complicated algorithm. AI used for internal and external control, as I said earlier, that it should think, it should operate internally as human do, and it should work externally as humans work. And you are continuously getting real-time signals you are getting from the sensors, and you have to take a decision. There should not be much time lag between your decision taking and the signal receiving, because if your decisions are late, by the time your system takes the action, your controller takes the action, some harm may have already been done. Now, for example, you want to stop a robot from moving. Now, the sensor has sensed there is something in front of the robot. If it is not fast enough, if there is a time lag, there is a latency, then by the time computer takes action or the robot takes action and stops, it may have already hit the human being. That means the time factor is very important. So it is a way, dynamic decision making. So what are the applications? Application may include industry application, including material handling, loading, unloading the machine tools, inspection. In inspection, it can work as a, it can take the component to an inspection machine, or the end effector of the robot can hold the inspection equipment and do the inspection itself, right? Personal help applications, very important aspect. Very important aspect from the society point of view, that there are few people who are physically handicapped. They cannot even eat, they cannot hold the spoon. If you can make a robot which is intelligent enough, depending upon the posture of the person, if it can feed with the spoon to the person, it is a great help. You can have a vacuum cleaner in your house. So it can go around the house, but we are afraid that it may hit something. No, robot may not hit that people or whatever it is, because it has a sensor which is continually sensing the environment. As soon as something comes in the range of the robot, it will change the path. It will not hit your dining table. It will not hit your center table. It will not hit your beds. It will just clean where it can go without hitting the appliances. Medical applications is a big area now, big area where robots are being applied. I have seen at one of the international conferences. So there is so much of research going in biomedical engineering applications in medicine. House vacuum cleaner, processing and assembly robots, medical applications, customized reports for individuals, as I said, material handling robots, surveillance robots, and many others. Surveillance report kya hai? Border, you have your army or police, they roam around, they take the rounds. But you can have robotic surveillance. They will not tire, they will not miss anything. The only thing is, we have to program them well. We have to program with due care. Many of your people are computer science people, they will know that they whenever their software is to develop, they develop something called SRS, system requirements study. What are the requirements? So all these programs, computer programs, or the machines with which the computer programs are integrated, they will work only if the SR is complete and thorough. All aspects have been considered in the SRS, that then only they will work. Otherwise, they will not work. So what I want to say is, when you want to design a machine, a robot, or AI program, you want to get it developed, the requirements should be very clear. You may not be a technical person. You may be a technical person, the person who is using it, who has more a lot of experience, he may not talk in the computer language. But we will convert. We as engineers, we will convert the information he has given into the engineering terms. But we should be able to listen to the person who is the user, take the inputs and convert it into technical language, what we want. Now we said the AI based machine, they should work, behave internally as humans do. They should think internally, right? People have started working on a lot of people have been working on ANN, artificial neural networks. It is like artificial intelligence only. We have artificial neural networks also. We have neural networks in our mind. So can the machine diagram itself? Can it take a decision based on the signals? In addition to doing outside work, we want the robot to do material handling work. We want to do it, work it for medical application. We want to the robot to feed a physically handicapped person. Can it monitor its own health depending upon the signals coming from different parts? Depending upon the noise coming from the V-belt, can it tell that this V-belt will break in some time? Can it monitor its own health? Power requirements. All these machines, what we are talking, all this automation, what we are doing, basically these are called power hungry machines. They consume a lot of power. Even the robots which we have in the industry, they may have a online, that means they may be connected to a power source, AC source or DC source, or they may be battery operated. One of the applications I was seeing, that when the robot is being used, after some intervals, it has to be charged because it is a battery operated device. So depending upon the minimum level set, the robot automatically will go to a charging station and plug in into the charging socket. Now there are decisions to be taken here, where the AI is coming. AI is coming because you never know at what point the battery power will be low. So the robot should search using the intelligence, which is the nearest powering station, recharging station. And what is the nearest path? At the same time, another robot should come into picture, because the robot which we are charging, it may take time to recharge. Now I cannot stop the work. So my robot should take care of, my system should, AI system should take care of that it employs another robot. Path planning, of course, we can see path planning. It is like a traveling salesman telling on problem also only. Work environment. It has to see the environment also, right? Maybe it can monitor the humidity level. It can monitor the temperature level. It can monitor the noise level. And there are two types of applications. One is a monitoring application, second is a control application. Now what are the monitoring applications? Monitoring applications are where you just take the data and the system gives you the data and you take action. Monitoring and control. Control is You take the data and the system itself takes the action, corrective action, right? So there is a difference between monitoring. Let's say you have a furnace. You set the temperature to be 700. The temperature, you switch it on, the sensors will keep on giving you data that okay, temperature is 600, 650, 690, 700. Once it reaches 700, you go and switch it off. That is monitoring. Whereas control is, as soon as the temperature reaches 700, the power supply is automatically switched off. And maybe at a preset value, when it again comes to 680 degrees, it is again switched on. The robot should behave externally like humans. Take decision based on the environment. For example, accident prevention, path change, right? As I said, planning and replanning. Anti-factor orientation, let's say you want to pick a component, right? You want to pick a component and your anti-factor means gripper is in a particular orientation. Now, depending upon the orientation of the component which it has to pick, the end effector should align itself, right? Interact with core robots. There is something called collaborative robots or other equipment. As I said, I gave you an example of the lathe machine where it has to interact with that, interlock with the machine system itself. I normally give one more example whenever I'm teaching this. Let's say you want a robot to be picking eggs, pick and place. As we know, the eggs are of varying sizes. Now the problem there is, if I hold the egg too loose, it may fall. If I hold it too tight, it may break. So that means we have to take a dynamic decision, real-time decision. How much should be the force acting on it? How much should be the clamping force? That can be taken based on the sensors. There should be a force sensor. You have to decide what you want. You can have planning. Planning is actually a simpler decision as compared to replanning. Right? You plan something. You say that I will do such and such thing, but there are some unforeseen circumstances. There are some reasons which you could not foresee. So how do you take a re-decision? You re-plan. That your AI systems will do. Your path planning, your path changing, right? All the decision making based on the inputs from sensors and other control algorithms, your AI systems can take care, which is useful in robotics hub. As I said, our system is working on basically sensors. We should be able to use the input from the sensor to take a intelligent decision. Now, sensors, you have read in the morning session, what type of sensors you are using, how you are integrating with the system, how you are taking the decisions. A very important sensor is robot vision or computer vision. Computer vision, we are talking. We are now all used to it because we have to mark our attendance through that computer vision system. So in computer vision, what you do is you use a camera. Now it can be for robot guidance. It has to move ahead. Second application is basically inspection systems. Those who are from mechanical, they will understand that these days that physical inspection by taking the micrometer or vernier caliper is almost going out. Now we are going for digital inspection that you scan the component and take a decision. In guidance system, the AI-based robot can take alternative route in case of any problem with the planned route. You have planned a route, it is known to the robot, but there are some problems on the way. So AI helps in taking a decision. Decision means you may have 2-3 paths. What do you want? You want the shortest route? Okay, it will take the shortest route. A robot will avoid collision and accidents based on the vision system input. What is AI doing in an inspection? Let's say you have many parameters. You see, in a single component, you can have many parameters. Like I have seen the car window sheet metal component being inspected through a scanning system. There are many parameters on the window which are to be inspected. One is you scan the window and compare with the already filled in values, stored values in the computer, that whether they are matching or not, and give the decision. Second, when AI comes into it, the system inspects some components, and let's say it is taking 100 parameters. Out of 100 parameters, it sees that 5 or 6 parameters are always correct. Right? They are always correct. So based on the artificial intelligence, as you as a human being would have done, what it does, it says, okay, I will not evaluate these 5-6 parameters. Maybe after 100 inspections, I will start again. I will take a sample and again evaluate it. That means you can reduce the working. So based on the past results, the AI-based system may decide what are the parameters which need inspection. Others may be skipped. As I said, can correct the orientation of the object to be lifted or anti-factor based on the object orientation. Either it will correct the orientation of the object to be lifted, or let's say you want to load a component into the machine spindle, or you want to put a component on the milling machine. It can change the orientation, right? It can work in identification and sorting of objects. Very important. Let's say you want to sort the objects. I will give you a simple example. Let's say you want to sort the apples. Apples are based on 2 sizes. If the size is bigger or weight is bigger than a particular given limit, it goes to one bin. The second, if it is less than that, it goes to the second bin. No problem. Apples are coming and the robot is sorting. But what happens if an apple is too big? So I can give the other limit also, that okay, up to 200 grams, I accept the apple. If it is less than 100, up to 100 grams, that means I accept the apple between 200 and 100. Either it is 100 or between 100 and 200. But if there is an apple which is coming with the weight 250 grams, it can reject it. It can put it in the third bin, that okay, this is not in the domain which I am working. There is something called imitation learning in robotics or in AI or in machine learning. So this is basically learning by seeing. What it does is that, let's say you are on a construction site. You put the robot there and the workers are working. The robot will follow, will scan and see what they are doing, how they are working. The robot can replicate. Search and rescue operations it can do. How people are doing search and rescue. In military application, in earthquakes and etc., buildings are where buildings are damaged and you have to take out people. Another very common example of AI is that you just see, you go to a marriage, you will find that it's a flying object. Now it is very common. You have a drone camera. A camera is moving above you and it is taking photographs. Now, if you have a simple camera on drone, okay, you are controlling with your hand. Okay, there is a remote control with the operator and he controls. But if it's an AI augmented camera, it can be told, it can be trained, where that this is the set of people, the only people where it should concentrate more. It should go to the other places also, but where the, let's say, the bride and bridegroom are there, then it should take more pictures in that area. And if they move, the drone should move. Okay, can I go to chats? Okay, let me see. There are 3-4 questions I'll try to answer. Okay, somebody has, Pushpinder Sharma, how many years from now it will take Indian industry to adopt AI and robotics? Pushpinder Sharma ji, we have been lax on all these aspects, this is the quality aspect. But I think we are now in a situation where we cannot ignore all this. Where we can ignore all this. So we have to adopt other, it is a question of survival. Either you do this or you will perish. So it has to, and we have the now expertise, we have the capability to all this. Is it easy economic to upgrade existing structure to update so that it may interface to robots? You see, there are retrofit systems. I'll tell you now, it is being recorded also. There were industries in Punjab, they were using only manual lathes till now. They try to retrofit it. What you are saying, that we have tried to upgrade the existing system. Systems worked. But the efficiency and accuracy doesn't come to that level, what is coming in new machine. So it is almost the new machines which are, let's say, in Ludhiana, you say, the machines which people are now buying, nobody is buying the manual machine. They are all buying now CNC machines, let's say. So automatically, this system has to be upgraded. Otherwise, we will be out. Otherwise, you see, because the capacity and efficiency of these machines is much, much higher. With the new machines. Otherwise, we'll be out. There are so many foreign countries which are willing to sell. They are still selling. And we have to take care, and we have to implement the new things. Mr. Abhi Garg, sir, what is the most popular programming language used in AI? You see, any language you can use. We have been using C, C++. You have been using Java. But now, what I feel is, because I am not from computer, in AI now, the language which being used is Python. I may or may not be correct. Okay. Okay. Mr. I have probably taken action. So there are no more queries. I have one or two more slides. I'll go back. Okay. So I hope this is visible now. Pankaj, it is visible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It's visible.
Okay. I think one more slide, and then we will stop. There is something called self-supervising learning. You see, there are many, many people coming from computer background in your session. The robots have self-supervising learning, that this enable robots to generate their own training examples in order to improve performance. So that the continuous improvement in the performance there, that they have their own system. It has to be programmed. A robot is a machine basically, or a computer is also a machine. It has to be programmed. You need to have specific programs, like that's a watch bot. This is a robot, is a concrete example created by researchers from Cornell and Stanford that uses a 3D camera, a 3D sensor, a camera, laptop, and laser pointer to detect normal human activity. What it does, it says it will scan your, let's say, I'm just making it simple. It will scan your kitchen and it will see whether you have left the milk container out. You want to put it into the refrigerator. If it is lying out, it will give you a signal. And earlier probably it gave 6%, 60% efficiency. That means 60% of the instances, it gave the correct information. So people are working on it to make it more accurate, more accurate. But just see, you also must be experiencing, especially in our area, if you leave milk outside during the night, it will be spoiled. But if you have a robot, if you have a system, if you have a camera, which can tell you, which can scan your kitchen and tell you that you have not kept the milk inside the fridge, probably it will be great help. Autonomous learning is a variant of self-supervised learning involving deep learning and unsupervised method that has been applied to robot and control tasks. This is autonomous learning, deep learning, machine learning, supervised methods, unsupervised methods, that probably we will leave here. And you have to, there will be people who will be talking on AI also now in your system. Robots in assistive and medical technology, very important application, in fact, very important application of robotics is in medicine, especially in surgeries. It is not that it is robot assisted, it is a remote controlled robotic surgeries also. As I said, a person sitting at a remote person place can perform the surgery in Sangrur. There are cobots, another term which is called cobots. Cobot is collaborative robots. That is more than one robots. Like a football match you must have seen on the TV, a robots playing a football match. Or like you have, let's say, when we transfer, let's say, bricks, you stand in a line and hand over the bricks to one another. We are human beings, we know that the brick is coming now, I should hold it. But robots can do it. They can talk to other robots, right? The intelligence machines, what I say is, intelligence machines will be able to talk to each other, talk to the environment, talk to the control system. So what is the summary? Combination of AI and robotics has huge potential in automating the working in many spheres. Decisions are taken based on the internal software inputs and on the signal from the sensors installed in the environment. Robots are not intelligent in themselves. They are made intelligent by control hardware and control software. So please, this is what I wanted to say. I think we are just in time. I have 5 minutes which we can devote to discussions if you want, if you have any questions. Otherwise, also you can talk if you want.
Participants, if you have any question, please, you may ask.
Good afternoon, Tejinder.
Good afternoon, sir. Yes, please, any question?
So if there are no questions, we'll stop it here. I thank Dr. And his team for inviting me to be a part. It was interesting. In fact, I have learned in this process many things, because I had to give a lecture, so you had to study and update yourself.
We always feel blessed, sir, whenever we got a chance to listen you with very simple examples and applications you shared AI robotics in it's I know it's your natural style of teaching. So on behalf of our participants, our faculty, our management, we all would like to thank you. Thank you very much, sir. From the day one when we thought about this topic, you were in my mind. I want to request you, and you, sir, I am very thankful to you. You always actually accept our request. So again, I am thankful to you on behalf of our department also.
Thank you, Tejinder. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Because he's your head of the department, please. For me, he's Tejinder Paul only. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you. We'll close here. Okay.
Thank you, Pavla sir. Thank you, Srao sir.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Attendance link is already posted in WhatsApp group and chat box also. And we will meet you, meet all the participants at sharp 9:30 tomorrow. So thank you, all of you. Thank you, Pavla sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Pavla sir. Thank you.